in a collinear, so spin polarized problem, also in the non-collinear problem, means that if you have a system where the spin orbit is important, there are many materials where now the spin orbit is important, from perovskite or transition metal decalcogenide, other system that are of interest nowadays, you can do it. Then I will show you some example of optical spectra calculated with YAMBO. And then if I have time, I will go through the step-by-step solution of the Bethe-Salpeter, so exactly what you will do this afternoon in the tutorial. So before moving to the Hedin equation, let me do some summary of what we have seen up to now about the response function. In the first day, Andrea spoke about the linear response, and you remember that the chi is the crucial quantity that you need, the microscopic response function, to calculate the epsilon minus one. And so Andrea has shown that it's possible to derive a Dyson equation from the independent particle response function. You can obtain what is called RPA, including local field, when you include this Coulomb interaction in this Dyson equation. And also, I don't remember if Andrea explained, but probably he mentioned in this in his talk, you can obtain the response, the chi, also in the time-dependent density functional theory, if you include the exchange correlation term here, that is the derivative of the exchange correlation functional potential with respect to the density. And so this is time-dependent DFT. But if you remember, this quantity is a microscopic quantity. What we need is the connection to the macroscopic quantity, and you learned that in order to obtain the macroscopic quantity, what you need is to do an inverse of this expression. So you have to do the macroscopic average and then make the inverse. And so at the end, in practice, what you did the first day is exactly to solve this equation. We did in the optical limit Q equal to zero because we were interested in the independent particle optical absorption spectrum, but exactly what you did is this one. Actually, you didn't do this because you calculate only the zero zero without including local field. I don't remember if in the tutorial the local field were included or not, but the expression is exactly this one, okay? But I have to say that in order to include this local field effect, so go from microscopic to macroscopic, there is another way to do that has not been mentioned up to now, that is to obtain an equation for a chi that is called chi bar. And the only difference is that in this equation, the Coulomb potential must be cut, the long range part. So this is shown mathematically that if you do in this way, the macroscopic dielectric function is directly related to the macroscopic average of this chi bar. So the way that you solve this equation, eliminating the long range part, that is exactly this definition, you obtain directly the macroscopic dielectric function. So you can do in this way or in this other way. You will understand in a moment that in the Bethe-Salpeter equation is much more convenient to use this definition to obtain the macroscopic one. Let me do another statement that was mentioned by Andrea, that a way to derive this equation or this one. So we understand that chi and chi bar are the same. The only difference is the introduction of a local field effect here, is that you can obtain this equation or this equation moving from an equation for the irreducible polarizability that goes from the independent one to the irreducible polarizability, where you include here the exchange correlation effect in the response. Then you can use a Dyson equation that connects the irreducible polarizability, that here I call the chi tilde, to the reducible one, that is exactly this one. And then doing this and combining with one of these two, you obtain this one or this one. Okay? So now you understand why I had to include this chi tilde that you didn't. So it is another one quantity is useful for the derivation that I will do now. Okay? So here are the definition of the property in the complex space of the response function in linear response. Okay, so now I will do a step forward because I will start from the second day lesson. So the chi was introduced in the linear response theory. If you noted in the many body approach, in the Dyson equation, Andrea and Daniele used the definition of pi, that is the reducible polarizability. Clearly the two are quantities that are clearly connected. We know exactly how to connect them, but it's just a formal point that I want to make. And if you note here, I called the irreducible polarizability not pi p, but pi tilde. Okay, you understand in a moment why I do in this way. Okay? So if you remember, this is the definition that you have seen in the two lessons of yesterday. And in particular, what I can say that the irreducible polarizability, pi tilde, is connected to the reducible polarizability in a similar way of the equation that I've shown before. So you can go through this Dyson equation from irreducible quantity to reducible one, both for the p and also for the p bar. So you can define an equation where if you want to have a macroscopic quantity, you define the Coulomb potential v bar, eliminating the long range part, and then you can move directly to the calculation of the macroscopic dielectric function through this equation. So you don't need to invert, but you use simply the pi bar, okay? And this is again a reducible quantity, while in the Edin equation, we are speaking about irreducible quantities that are calculated diagrammatically, okay? So the goal now is to find an equation for pi tilde beyond the independent particle approach, that is what we have seen up to now, because we have calculated only pi zero, let's say that is the independent one. And then we want to calculate the equation essentially for pi bar, because my goal is to calculate the macroscopic dielectric function. And so we come back to the Edin equation. So here, instead of calling p, I call p tilde, just to remember that it is the irreducible quantity that I want to calculate doing another cycle or iteration in the Edin equation. And this is exactly what I do. So I start with the self-energy, that is what we learned yesterday, that is GW, and we stop here, okay? But if you do, if you remember, gamma is defined in a compact way in this way, so there is a functional derivative of the self-energy with respect to the G. And now if you start with the sigma that is GW, you end exactly in this term, EW, and this part. And this part is what Fulvio mentioned and also Davide before mentioned, that is generally the first approximation that is done in the Bethe-Salpeter equation. So you assume that this term is negligible, so you delete completely. And so the functional derivative of the sigma is simply EW, okay? And so at the end, we arrive to an equation for the vertex that, if you remember explicitly, is a three-point equation in space and time, that is this one. So, but my goal is to obtain an equation for pi tilde. And so the idea is that from gamma, I have to arrive to an equation for pi tilde. And so what I can do? I can multiply the gamma vertex obtained in the way that I've shown by 2g green function here and here. And then doing an integration, I obtain exactly an equation for this pi tilde 3 vertex equation that appear diagrammatically in this way. So you have the delta, let's say, vertex, that GG, that is this one, and this part that is represented by this part here. But this is not the end, because to describe the propagation of the electron hole and see their interaction, we need a four-point quantity. So you can imagine to open also this point here, 3, and generalize to a four-point polarizability, tilde. And so at the end, we obtain an equation for the irreducible polarizability from the Edin equation doing another cycle with an approximation where we are including the electron-hole interaction inside. So this is the independent polarizability the RPA, and this is what we have derived from the Edin equation during doing a second iteration. Okay, so these are the definition. So doing it in the same way that I mentioned before, you can use this equation for the irreducible polarizability, and the equation that connect the irreducible polarizability to the reducible one, in particular pi bar, because I want to the macroscopic quantity, and then if you combine the two, you arrive to the equation that is exactly similar to what Fulvio presented before, with some difference that now I'll try to explain. So you see that here you have the P0, that is the free electron hole propagation, and here you have this kernel, that is the V bar. Now I explicitly put V bar because I'm interested in macroscopic quantity, and W, that as you can see is a negative quantity, and represent, I'll show you in a minute, the electron hole attraction. So this is what Fulvio called before. There was an I of difference in the definition, but I mean, is inside the definition of P. So they cancel out at the end. Okay, so the equation is this one. Diagrammatically, you can say that the equation, the four-point equation of the polarizability is this. You have the pi zero, that are two independent electron and hole propagation. And then here is the kernel that describes the interaction. And again, you have this term. You see that if you go through the index, I use the compact notation, but if you use all the index, you see that the diagram are done in this way. So if this is 1528, the connection is 1258, 1528. So they are not equivalent, okay? They are really 4 point. You cannot have the same diagram, and so you cannot, in principle, have a 2 point from here. Okay, so this part is what we call electron hole exchange interaction, and this is something that is repulsive. Note that this actually, from the derivation, is an electron hole exchange, but actually comes from the Hartree term. So it's quite strange, okay? But we are speaking about electron hole exchange interaction. And here, this is the electron hole direct interaction that is attractive. So this is negative, okay? So which are the approximations? Because up to now, we didn't mention that W, in principle, is a time, depend from time. So here, in principle, you have something like T and T prime are different, R and prime are different. So the main approximation that we do, actually, and is done in the code, is assume that this interaction is static, is what we were discussing before. So it's exactly the calculation, the W0 calculated at RPA level. And this is a in this way, you understand that this is the first approximation that we do. And also, we have neglected the change of the screening with respect to G, the approximation that I've shown before. And the other thing is that clearly, in this equation, there is G0, G0. And here, the renormalization factor, the dynamical factor zeta and kappa that is that Andrea was discussing before, in principle, should be put there. Instead, what we do is to assume that it's one. Okay, and this means to cancel out the dynamical effect in the definition of P0 and the dynamical effect here. So what was what Andrea was discussing before. Okay, so now we can, now that everything is defined, we can look at the connection with the macroscopic quantity. And as you remember, since I move to P bar, I can simply do the average, and the average in G space means to take the G prime equal to zero term. This is the expression. And this is the macroscopic one. Clearly, if you want to have the polarizability, what you have to do is to contract the two index at the end of the, at the beginning and at the end of the 4 point polarizability in this way. So if you do that, you can pass from the Fourier transform definition of the P bar. This is this one. And then, as before, you can move, this is what is done in the code, to the transition space. So multiply for a couple of block state, N1, N2, N3, N4, And you have the definition that allow to move from the real and time space, omega space, to the transition space. So in this way, we arrive exactly at what Fulvio has shown before. If you remember, before he used chi instead of pi bar, but we are exactly the same, and he used k to index the transition. Here I explicitly put n1 and n2 to mean a transition from n1 to n2 that can be nk if we have an extended system, only valence conduction, or valence valence, or conduction conduction. Here is just a couple of index to another couple. Okay. So what we do now is assume that we can do exactly in the same that Fulvio discussed. So we can write this p bar through the inverse of an excitonic Hamiltonian that is already introduced by him. And the excitonic Hamiltonian is again the here. I mean, in this approach, you see immediately that the energy is the proper way to introduce the quasi-particle energy, because we started from the calculation of the energy in the GW approach. So here it's very natural to include the quasi-particle energy calculated at the G0W0 level. And here, this is the kernel. And these are the occupation between two states. And if you go through a more explicit definition of this excitonic Hamiltonian, you can see the excitonic Hamiltonian, in principle, is appear in this way. And you have that, okay, this part we will see later, we will focus later, but you see that in this non-diagonal part, the independent particle part here is zero, so you don't have this. Also here, all these two parts are completely zero of the matrix due to the fact that both this and this one are zero. And then what we do is the fact that since we want to calculate the p bar, you see here this term are occupation, and clearly if the occupation are valence valence or conduction conduction, this term cancel out. So we this part of the matrix does not enter in the calculation of the p bar. We are interested only in this part. And this is exactly the part that Fulvio actually shown probably only this one. So this is we are arriving to the final definition that you have seen before. Okay. So we cancel out this because they do not enter in the definition of the p bar, because we need only the transition from occupied to unoccupied state. But as you can see, the matrix is more general, and you have a couple. Two parts that are, I show you here, are generally called the resonant part that are between valence conduction, valence prime, conduction prime, and the opposite in principle, but you can show that one and the other one are exactly one, the conjugate matrix of the other. And then you have the part that is decoupling, that is called K. And you can show that the matrix, this part R is Hermitian, that is called resonant part. This is the anti-resonant part. And this is what is called in the code also coupling. And it can be shown that this matrix is symmetric. So in principle, what you have in the code is all these matrix. But what we will do this afternoon, for instance, generally it can be shown that the coupling part is small, means that these two parts that represent the propagation of electron and hole, let's say anti-electron and anti-hole, can be decoupled. So if these two terms are small, these are decoupled, and you end in what in TDDFT approach is called the Tan-Dankov approximation. And this approach is generally good to describe the optical absorption spectra of all the material when the excitation related to exciton and plasmon are very well separated. So generally in semiconductor, in traditional material, extended material, it's a good approximation. And actually, you can see that since these two matrices are exactly the same, at the end you can completely neglect also this part. What you will do this afternoon is calculate this matrix that is called the resonant part of the Hamiltonian. And this is the approach that is good to calculate the optical absorption spectra of most of material. Remember that if you are interested instead in energy loss calculation, it has been shown that in general it is important to include these two terms in the definition of the macroscopic directive function. Okay? So now what I want to do is to go more deep in the definition, look at the matrix element of the excitonic Hamiltonian, and in particular see which is the role of spin, because up to now we use only index N1 and N2 without saying which is the spin of the electron and hole. So we have essentially three cases. We can say that we can have a system that we call collinear, so non-spin polarized, where S square and SZ are all good quantum number. We can have collinear case, so system that are magnetic, where the spin polarization is important, and in general SZ is a good quantum number. Or we have what is called non-collinear case, where nor S square or SZ are good quantum number. So this means that in principle, in the collinear case, you can have the definition of the wave function that is in principle a spinor, but one of the two components are completely zero, so you have a state that are up or down, and in general in the non-collinear, in the collinear case, non-spin polarized, it will be a random combination of up and down wave function. And then instead, for the non-collinear case, actually the wave function is described really by a spinor. So this means that in the collinear case, in principle, you have that the wave function of the up and down channel are equal, epsilon up and down channel are equal. In this case, they are not. But in any case, when you describe the propagation of the electron, you can define the index n to indicate the state valence or k, whatever you want, and also sigma, that means up or down. So it's a very good definition, while when you want to describe diagrammatically an electron, a hole that propagate, you have to describe the state considering the fact that you have, I called here N capital, that embed the fact that you are describing a spiral. So you have both the component up and down in this expression, and the energy clearly depend from this index N. So you have a double of state with respect to the unpolarized case. Okay, so now we can go to look at the excitonic Hamiltonian and making explicit the index of the spin. So the excitonic Hamiltonian is defined in this way. So we start with the collinear case that is useful when you have a spin polarized system. So we have this expression. I called here the diagonal part, that is what we have seen before. And now you note clearly that there is a conservation of the spin, sigma g, sigma c prime, sigma b, sigma b prime. So it's completely diagonal. And then we end with the exchange part. In this case, if you remember, the diagram is done in this way. So it means that you have a conservation of the spin here, of the spin component here and here. Clearly, I assume that the Coulomb potential here does not depend from the spin. So we are doing this approximation. And so in this way, this means that if you go to write the matrix element of the exchange part, that is what is called V of V bar, depending from the definition, you end with this matrix element. So you have the same spin here and the same spin here. In the W, we have the diagram that is opposite, because it's not exactly the same like V. And so you have the conservation of the spin at this point and at this point. And so if you go through the definition, you see that here you have the same index in two conduction, CC prime, and the same index in V and V prime. Okay, so how looks like the matrix in the spin space? If you go to see the matrix in the spin space, you can see that the matrix appear in this way. and you have a lot of zero that do not mix channel while you have a spin flip, actually. So you have two blocks, and you can see that actually this block here means a transition like this, up, down, down, up. That clearly I put this plus minus because this one is not equivalent to this one, because we have the dependence of up and down in the matrix element through the energy and through the wave function. So the elements are not all the same in the general case. And then you have the other part, that is this block here, that describes instead the transition up, up, or down, down. And these clearly are the only transition that contribute to the optical absorption spectrum within the dipole approximation, due to the fact that you have the spin selection rule to be applied. Okay? But what happens when you have the spin non-spin polarized case? In that case, clearly not only SZ is a good quantum number, but also S square. So it's more convenient to rotate a matrix in the space of singlet and triplet. So what you can do is a combination of the couple up, up, down, down, and up, up, down, down in this way to obtain the singlet and triplet exciton. And so if you do that, you obtain a matrix that appears in this way. So these are exactly the equation that we have seen before. Fulvio didn't mention, but here the two comes really from the fact that you are describing singlet exciton, okay? And this part here, instead, is what we call triplet exciton. You see that are completely equivalent. So actually, if you want to calculate singlet exciton, this is the way. That is what we will do this afternoon. If you want to calculate triplet exciton, you have to turn off this part. So what we learn from here is that the triplet, for instance, are always lower in energy with respect to the singlet, and this is because this term is negative. So you add a positive quantity here. And the other things is that clearly singlet can be bright because they are spin allowed, dependent from the other selection rule, while triplet are dark because they are spin forbidden. Okay? So what happened instead when we move to the full spinolier case? The main difference is the following. As mentioned before, when you have a non-spinorial case, each propagator has a sigma, that is the component of the spin that goes with it. And so you have that since the Coulomb potential, the interaction does not depend from spin, there is a conservation, so sigma, sigma. And what you have to do in the equation to obtain the matrix element is do an integral only over the spatial R, while phi sigma and phi sigma are well defined here. Instead, when you have to do to calculate the matrix element, at the end you have term where you are transporting a spinor, that is I and j in this case, what I called before n. And so what we have to do is not only do an integral over r, but also sum over the sigma component. So you have to sum over the two channels of the spinor that you are transporting. And so at the end, what you have is that the beta salpeter formally seems very similar to the previous one, what I've seen in the very initial slide. But here, the index are the index of the spinor state. So clearly, this means that with respect to the non-spin polarized case, the matrix is 4 times larger because you have the double of state, so the 4-time transition. So the matrix is much larger than before. And actually, if you look in the matrix element, there is this sum in the two components of the spinor that I was mentioning before. Okay? And so this is the end of the discussion, but now just me show you how the matrix element appears, so what is programmed in YAMBO. The kernel, the exchange kernel, if you transform is like you have seen yesterday for JGW, is appear like a single sum in G space, the Coulomb potential, and what we call the oscillator that was defined like rho, probably by Daniele, I don't remember. Okay, while the correlation part, that is this direct part, as you see, as a sum over 2G, G and G prime, because there is this screened Coulomb potential that was W that enter here, and so this is much more cumbersome to calculate. Like in GW, the exchange part is much less time consuming than the correlation part. Okay, so now how up to now we have seen all the definition of the matrix element, so now we have to understand how to obtain the spectrum. So we have to remember the relationship between the P bar that we have assumed is related to the inverse of the excitonic matrix and the macroscopic epsilon. And in YAMBO you can do in two ways. You can invert the matrix, and you can do with the LAPAC or ScalaPAC library, but it's not very efficient. And there is a way that is the recursive approach, Laxos Hidock approach. You will do the tutorial this afternoon, and is very efficient and parallelized. And also, if you are interested in looking really at the excitonic state, for instance, you want to plot the spatial distribution of the exciton, you want to have the excitonic eigenvector, so you have to use the spectral representation. But as you can see here, I put a more general one, also because the matrix in principle is the full matrix that is not only the resonant part. So the full matrix is this pseudo-Hermitian matrix that means that you have an overlap part here. And so this can be done with the LAPAC ScalaPAC in YAMBO, parallelized also, but there are also new subroutines that are called SLEPC or PETC that are appropriate to obtain the eigenvalues and eigenvector of a large scale sparse matrix. And in general, is interesting if you have a very big system, so very large matrix to be diagonalized, but you are interested specifically only in few eigenvector or eigenvalues. So there is a way to do it. We didn't put in the tutorial, but if you're interested, you can ask. And so the equation that appear if you go through the previous definition that I mentioned before of the p-bar, and using the full spectral representation, this one, is exactly this one. So you see that the expression is much, a little bit more complicated. Clearly, you see here that you have the real and the imaginary part of the full matrix. If you go to calculate only the resonant part of the excitonic Hamiltonian, that is what you will do this afternoon, actually the eigenvectors become orthogonal, so you have only the Hermitian part of the matrix, and you end up, here I wrote only the imaginary part, so I took only the imaginary part of this expression simplified, with this expression that is exactly what Fulvio has shown before. Probably what you can see here is that you can end up exactly with the definition of Fulvio if you use the definition of the velocity in this way. You end up exactly in what Fulvio has written before. Okay? So this is the dipole. And the dipole is the excitonic dipole, means that you are doing transition from the ground state to an excitonic state lambda, and you want to calculate which is the probability to have this transition through this dipole that is the exactly excitonic corresponding dipole with respect to the independent particle that is this one. Okay, so in the independent particle approach, you calculate this one. In the Bethe-Salpeter, you are mixing through the excitonic eigenvector the dipole of the independent particle approach. Okay, so this is to obtain the spectrum through excitonic eigenvalues and eigenvector. Instead, to obtain the spectrum from the iterative solution, you can start from the final definition and do some simple mathematics. So rewrite the velocity through the definition that I've shown before, and then you can explicit this modulo square in the two element and use the sum over lambda, lambda, lambda that is equal to 1. So at the end you end up with this definition of the spectrum. And this definition of the spectrum, you can apply the recursive approach, because you remember that if you have the spectrum defined in this way, where this is the initial vector, that is exactly what I've shown here, this one. you can define this, matrix element, so transform the matrix in a three diagonal way and then invert through this recursive approach. So what you need is to calculate the coefficient, the state I plus one, and then use this definition to calculate the spectrum. So clearly in this way, you don't have eigenvalues, eigenvector, you have only the finite spectrum. And this is very efficient, so you can use very big matrix. When you have problem on memory, this is the only way to do it beyond the approach that I mentioned before. And it converges very fast, generally less than 100 iterations, is parallelized and scale very well with MPA parallelization. And note that you can do this not only for the resonant part of the Hamiltonian, but there is a work by Mirta Gruning and Andrea Marini where they extended this iterative solver also for the full matrix. So if you're interested in a calculation also considering the coupling part of the Hamiltonian, you can do it and obtain directly the spectrum. Okay? So now the last part, I have time, is that I show some examples that are quite old, so probably not very interesting, but okay, this is school. And so this is the very famous spectrum of silicon. You can see this is again the RPA, normal RPA, this is GW. So you shift to up energy, and then you have a completely renormalization of the intensity of these two peaks, E1 and E2, only through the solution of the beta salpeter. And so you have a comparison with the experiment that is quite good. It's not perfect, and because here the temperature effect in the solution of the beta salpeter has not been taken into account. Probably you know that it's possible to include the thermal effect in the calculation of the beta salpeter. There are works from Andrea Marini, and recently people use a frozen phonon approach to calculate the thermal average, and so calculate beta salpeter spectra, including the thermal effect. Okay? And so this is the other example that has been shown before, probably. Again, this is a solid argon, and if you calculate the RPA, this is what you obtain. If you calculate the GW, this is what you obtain. So the electronic gap is very large, about 14 eV, while if you include electron-hole interaction, you end up again with a very nice agreement with the experimental curve. And again, this difference from 12 to 14 is what is called the excitonic binding energy. That clearly in a material like argon, since the screening is very small, is quite large. And so here are other examples. This just to show you that in the past, what has been done by Andrea is use the beta salpeter for three materia that are here. And so the agreement with the experiment that are the blue curve with the red, with the black is quite good. But in this paper, if you go through this paper, you realize that in this derivation, what they were trying to do is trying to use the time-dependent approach to calculate the beta salpeter, to calculate the optical absorption spectra. And I don't know if you are aware, in time-dependent DFT, generally the optical spectra are good only for finite system. And this is due to the fact that the exchange correlation kernel is not exact. In particular, you don't have the long range term 1 over Q squared that is instead inside the W that is in the beta salpeter. So what they did in this work is start from the many body kernel, so exactly use the equation for chi in time dependent DFT and the equation for P in the many-body approach, so beta-salpeter. So they extract this many-body kernel from the beta-salpeter, and they obtain an FXG that is defined like many-body kernel, if I remember well. And in this way, you see the red and black are perfectly equal. So in principle, it's possible also to do calculation in time-dependent DFT using this kernel. But from computational point of view, up to now is not convenient in the sense that in any case you have to use the beta salpeter, extract the kernel, and then do time-dependent DFT. So it's not very useful for in this at this moment. Okay, so these are other results. This is a very old results from our group always. This is the reflectance anisotropy spectrum of a surface that is the diamond 100. The surface, when you cut along this direction, form dimer at the surface, and this dimer break the isotropic optical response of the material. And so if you use light polarized in one direction or in the other, you obtain a very strong signal that comes from the initial surface state, and so you can measure this anisotropy. And what we did here is to compare the measure, that is this continuous curve, with the excitonic calculation. And as you can see, the agreement seems very nice. I didn't present the RPA that is completely off. So the nice thing is that in this material seems that there are excitons that are bound like 1 eV, that is quite strong for a normal semiconductor material. This is another example where doing an average on a molecular dynamic snapshot, they were able to calculate the optical absorption spectrum of liquid water that seemed to reproduce this optical feature of the experiment. Probably there are more recent results on that, but I'm not aware. So now we can move to other results that are, for instance, nanowires. Here is another work where what we have shown is try to compare the excitonic gap with the optical gap measured in different nanowire of different orientation and different size. What you can see that clearly doing a quasi-particle calculation only, the gap is completely off from the experiment that are the yellow, while when include for three different orientation the excitonic gap, we move in the region of the experiment. And also in this way, at that time, we were able to explain the optical absorption of porous silicon that is experimentally is a combination, a random combination of different wire of different orientation. And here again, you can see that using the definition of singlet and triplet exciton, you can see which is the what is called the difference between triplet and singlet, the exchange splitting. And again, for this material, you can see a nice agreement between theory and experiment for different nanowires. Okay, so now something more about low-dimensional material. This is another paper, also this one quite old, where you can look again at the dimensionality effect, what Fulvio discussed before. Here, these are different nanotubes. Okay, sorry, this is the bulk of boron nitride, and these are the absorption spectrum. This is the boron nitride sheet, single sheet. You can see that the spectrum is more or less similar. And these are different optical spectra calculated for different tubes of different dimensionality. And you can note that reducing the dimension of the tube, the bonding energy, that is the difference between the first peak, optical peak, and the GW gap that is indicated here by this arrow, is very, very big. This is because more the system is smaller and more the bonding energy increases. But another thing that you can note here is this one, that the GW, if you, okay, this calculation clearly are obtained in a repeated cell approach. And that time, it was not included the Coulomb potential, the cutoff in the Coulomb potential. And what you can note here is that, in principle, if you want to simulate an isolated material, you have to increase the vacuum. And you see clearly that the GW gap increase, increasing the distance between the tubes in this case, while the bonding energy increasing the distance increases too. Instead, the position of this peak, of the optical peak, more or less is stable. Okay, and so this is due to the fact that you have a compensation between the opening of the GW effect and the closing of the beta salpeter. So the two effects more or less compensate, but clearly you see a very strong effect due to the dimensionality. If you want to do better, what you can do, and is actually implemented in Yambo now, is really in order to simulate an isolated material, include a cutoff in the Coulomb potential in order to eliminate the image-image interaction. And in this way, you can see that differently from before, you see that the bonding energy is more stable with vacuum if we include the cutoff. But the nasty things that you can learn from here, that in case that you use cutoff, if you are interested to do it, you have to pay attention to the convergence in K points. Because if you look at the macroscopic dielectric function of the 2D material, you discover that in Q space has this shape. And this means that you must have a very, very dense K grid to describe this part. If not, you are not able to reach convergence. So if you are interested in cutoff, you can do it, and so you eliminate the problem to increase the vacuum size, but pay attention because you have to pay attention in the convergence in the K grid. Okay, so this is another example just to show you that it is also possible, as mentioned before, to do calculation in spin polarized system. This is a boron nitride again sheet where Claudio and Andrea and other people did calculation for different vacancy and different defect in boron nitride. And these are the difference between the level, DFT level, and the quasi-particle level. So you see that there is a very strong upshift of the unoccupied state and the downshift of the occupied states. And also from this paper, what we learn is that all these defect can be responsible of the visible photoluminescence in this material that seemed quite interesting for a single photo emission in this material, photoemitter in this material. Okay, the last example is this one. This is another material that is quite interesting in this year. This is molybdenum disulfide. And in this paper, what I've shown is that it's possible to reproduce the experimental optical spectra of monolayer, B-layer, and bulk, only including spin orbit, because these two peaks are due to the splitting of the valence band, essentially due to the spin orbit effect, and are what is called A and B exciton. And in this figure, you see what is the plot of the excitonic wave function. So if you want to know which is the distribution of the exciton in space, you can do it. You will do it this afternoon. And this is actually the modulus square of the wave function. Okay, the last example is some example where the Tam-Dankov approximation is not good. So means that in some material, you are obliged to include all the matrix in the description because this part is important. I have to say, probably I didn't mention before, that this term is important all the time that you have a material that is quite inhomogeneous in the charge density. So for instance, in all the organic material is quite important. In all the molecule is quite important to include all the matrix. If not, you do not end up in the proper description. And here is the difference, for instance, for the Tam-Dankov approximation that are here for these two chromophores and the experiment. You see that are completely off from the experiment, while if you include the full beta-salpeter, full the matrix, you have a much nicer agreement. And this is another example shown by Mirta and Andrea in that paper, where they have shown that also for nanotube, if you are interested in impinging electron and measuring electron energy spectra at a certain angle, so you are considering also the perpendicular component of the macroscopic dielectric function, you end up in big difference in some peak. So this is the difference between Tam-Dankov and non-Tam-Dankov approximation. Similar, this is an example in porphyrin. Porphyrin is a quite interesting material. In the gas phase, we were able to reproduce with the GW beta-salpeter approach the experimental optical spectra that are here. This is the small version of this matrix without this four part. But you can note that, again, the agreement is good only when you include you go beyond the Tam-Dankov approximation. So the peak reproduce the experiment all in that case. And also for crystal of porphyrin is the same situation. This is the experimental spectrum done by a group in Milan for two light polarization in one direction or in another. Okay, this is a crystal of zinc porphyrin. The porphyrin in the gas phase is completely isotropic. What turned out in the experiment that you have a very anisotropic peak in this region. And we were able to reproduce this feature only including the coupling part in the excitonic Hamiltonian. So we had to go beyond the Tan-Dankov approximation because the position of the peak changed completely. If you do Tan-Dankov, you have a peak here. If you don't do Tan-Dankov, you have a peak here. So it's quite important. And also, you can see again that this is a way that you can look at this afternoon when you will do the calculation in the 2D material. There is a way to understand when the coupling part is important. This is what we call the amplitude that give you an idea if the exciton lambda is built up by electron hole or electron and the hole that are called anti-electron and anti-hole, so the anti-resonant part of the matrix. And you see that there is a big part of this amplitude of positive energy, so normal transition, valence conduction, and a small but not negligible part from conduction to valence in the representation. Okay? And so I can go very fast in the last part, or no? I will do this afternoon, it's the same.
We can
do this afternoon. Okay, so this is the practical part that we will see this afternoon, so it's not a problem. Okay, stop.